There has never been a better time in history to be born female.
No interviewer, no journalist, just two legends.
Thank you for giving us two words and a hashtag that helped free us, because we are all Me Toos.
Power only understands power. Power will look for weakness in the opponent. I do not reflect weakness.
My time with the Spice Girls, when we put our energies and ambitions together, we were formidable.
I did question, why am I here? Continually throughout my life.
And it was a total shock to see right across Africa, forests disappearing, chimpanzee numbers dropping.
Foreign correspondents can be in this very, very precarious position of actually tilting things.
Trailblazing women sharing their truths and how they created their unique path to success. Inspiring, revealing, empowering. This episode of The Power of Women is Mel C, pop star, actress, TV personality and Spice Girl. Jane Lush, chair of BAFTA, 35 years commissioning at the BBC.
When I commissioned Strictly Come Dancing, everybody thought that I'd lost it. She's bringing back ballroom dancing to a Saturday night.
We were having none of it. We wanted to sign a deal. We wanted to move forward. We wanted to get out there. We want it now. I was a little bit nervous meeting you.
Oh, no.
Because I think your achievements are quite incredible. So I didn't really know what to expect.
I'm a very ordinary girl.
But don't you find, as a woman who has achieved a lot in certain fields where often men dominate, people wonder what to expect from a woman like that?
What's never true with men, but it's so often people think about women, which is that if they've achieved, they have to have been nasty or tough or something. And those are things that people never level at men. Successful women are successful because they've been able to use their abilities. Not because they're nasty.
Yeah. I was reading a little bit about you, and I was really interested to hear that the beginnings of your life started where I have ended up, and my daughter's life has begun. I think you were born in Marylebone.
Yeah, I was born in the Middlesex Hospital, right in the middle of town, what's now called Fitzrovia. It wasn't called Fitzrovia in those days.
Yeah.
I was born in my mother was born in Belgium, and all four of my grandparents were born in Eastern Europe. But I do think of myself as a Londoner.
Yeah.
What do you think of yourself as?
Oh, gosh. I suppose, I'm very northern at heart. Those are my roots. I was brought up just outside Liverpool. Beyond that, very Celtic, actually. Scotland, Ireland, some Welsh roots as well. But I suppose my time with the Spice Girls pretty much made me feel like very British. I'm very proud to be British. We literally flew the flag, or Jerry wore the flag.
For sure.
Around the world. And it also made me feel, I think the industry that I work in, I get to travel a lot. And I was so lucky being part of a band that did have international success. I feel like a citizen of the world.
The one and only Melanie C. She's sold over 55 million records and she's written 11 UK number one singles.
Your home girls, the Spice Girls.
Jerry Halliwell has left the Spice Girls. Is there life for the other four? We'll have to wait and see.
It probably would be quite tough for me to get a deal because it's quite difficult for people to forget about the Spice Girls and to accept me as an individual.
Melanie Chisholm's acting debut in the musical Blood Brothers was nominated for an Olivier Award. Successful performer, songwriter and DJ, she is an ambassador for several charities. As a solo artist, sold over 3 million albums and numerous number one singles.
La 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 la. La 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 la.
BAFTA Chair Jane Lush.
We at BAFTA feel so strongly about working together to reset the tone. BAFTA unequivocally promotes a professional environment that protects all who work in it from bullying or harassment.
Jane Lush, founder of the PAFC, trailblazing producer, controller of daytime and factual programming at the BBC. She introduced award-winning shows such as Strictly Come Dancing and The Weakest Link.
One of the very, very few bands that was able to break America. You were the, still are the exception.
Yeah, it's a pretty tough nut to crack. There are lots of things that we achieved, and I believe, obviously, five very strong girls, when we put our energies and ambitions together, we were formidable. We didn't doubt ourselves ever. And we just
really?
Thought, yeah, whatever we want, we can do it.
Did you, when you were younger, did you think, I know I'm going to be successful?
There were times when I look back, I must have been so obnoxious.
Because, I'm sure you were.
Well, it is funny because, you know, I was very ambitious and I had a lot of self-belief, and it's really odd because when I did become successful with the girls, that was when my self-esteem wavered. You know, that was the first time, for whatever reason that was. I think a lot of it was to do with the media and the reality of fame and being in the public eye. That was the first time I really doubted myself. We used to go to dance competitions, and I was quite vocal about not being happy if I didn't win something. I was like, well, I was the best. Why didn't I win? And you think about that as an adult, it's like, oh, cringe. But they're still my friends, so I couldn't have been so bad.
That's brilliant because, you know, it's kind of, it's our duty to believe in ourselves, because why should we expect anybody else to believe in us if we don't believe in ourselves? And I think we all go through, well, I can only talk for myself, periods in our lives when sometimes we believe in ourselves and sometimes you have that thing where you think somebody's going to tap you on the shoulder and say, ah, I've caught you, found you out, you know, everything that's happened has just been, you know, it's just been good fortune rather than good skills or whatever you like. But I didn't go to university. I joined the BBC straight from school as a trainee secretary. I thought, I'm just going to go in and make waves. And it didn't happen like that. It took 9 years after joining to even be taken remotely seriously as somebody who might have a career. To be honest with you, I was enjoying it and I'd kind of got there and I was overawed by what I saw as all the sort of brainy people there. And I thought, well, I'll just have a sort of a nice little job. And it actually took a couple of women who said to me, come on, Jane, you know, you could be a director, you could be this, you could be that. Well, could I was really nervous. Once they pushed me and I sort of dipped my toe in a slightly deeper pool, then the rest sort of happened much more quickly. But it is about confidence and resilience.
You know, I came from a working class background and we got together when I was about 20. I wasn't very worldly. I'd done some travelling, but nothing extensive. And we were finding ourselves in these, you know, incredible places with very powerful people. And everybody wanted us. You know, there was something about the Spice Girls. It was, people were very excited about, you know, what we could achieve and people wanted to be a part of that. It just brought us to these situations where I think a person from my background would feel very intimidated. But because the five of us were together and we had this strength, it just made me realise it doesn't matter where you're from and it doesn't matter what your experience is. You should really try at least to feel comfortable anywhere. Don't be intimidated. And I've carried that through life. And for example, if somebody goes to a nice restaurant and they've never been to a nice restaurant and they feel a little bit intimidated, they're not sure what to order from the menu or which knife and fork to use and all those things. It's like, that's nonsense. It's nice to just be where you are and be confident in yourself. It's incredible how many high-powered people in these roles feel the same.
Everybody in their head is shy, I think. I really believe that. I don't think there's anybody, or there's very few people, who will go into a party or a social situation on their own and feel absolutely comfortable about that. There's always that, my God, suppose nobody talks to me, suppose I'm just standing there. Whoever you are, I think we've all got to understand that we've all got frailties.
I feel nervous about everything. I've watched interviews and, you know, certain performances I've done and I know my internal dialogue has been going, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. But I look fine. I look like I'm really confident. So I think that is a good trick.
It's weird because I was chair of BAFTA for 2 years and one of the things you have to do is you have to stand up and give a speech, the big ones at the Film Awards and the TV Awards. And the first time I had to do that, which is walk onto the stage of the Royal Albert Hall and give a speech, and there was Mel Brooks, and there was Prince William, and there was Meryl Streep. And I just stood backstage and I just thought, I can't do it, I just can't do it. Anyway, you do, because you have to, and you walk on. And then afterwards, everybody says to me, oh, you look so relaxed. That obviously comes to you so naturally. Relax. I was absolutely petrified.
And when you'd come off, could you remember how it had gone? And
I can remember thinking, oh my God, I'm doing it. I'm looking out. I can see everybody because all the lights are on the audience. I could actually see all these people. And I remember just thinking, try and enjoy it because you will look back on this as being like a very special moment in your life. So just try and live the moment and enjoy the moment. But you must have had loads of moments to like just live and enjoy and...
Absolutely. I had a little bit of an epiphany a few years ago because I'm very hard on myself. A bit of a failed perfectionist. So each performance I would come off and rather than really enjoying, you know, what you've done, it would be picking holes in it and what can be bettered. And I was performing with the We Will Rock You cast and Brian May from Queen was coming on stage. I'm a huge Queen fan. Like, all of my, you know, life, I've absolutely loved the band. And I was petrified. And I just thought, just enjoy it. I'm going to go out there and instead of worrying about every single note, I'm just going to lap it up, you know, every second.
As women, we're sometimes not just hard on ourselves, but we're too keen to wear our hearts on our sleeves. So we'll come off from doing something, whether it's a performance or whatever it is, a job or a job interview or something, and we'll immediately start to sort of put ourselves down and then tell other people, this is what I did wrong. I honestly think is more of a female trait, whereas a man will bluster his way through. You so rarely see men after saying something, well, I did so badly. They just don't do that.
Yeah, it's like we kind of say, look, these are our weaknesses.
Yeah, these are our weaknesses.
It's kind of, you know what I feel actually as a performer and as a woman, you kind of think you want to get in there before somebody else does. If, for example, if I went out and I was photographed on a red carpet and the dress looked terrible, I'd want to go on social media and go, oh, that dress was awful, before everybody else says it. It's kind of like...
Self-preservation.
Yeah, yeah, I think maybe a little bit of that. And I think you're right, maybe more of a male thing would be
to... What do you try and instill in your daughter, then?
My daughter is incredible. She, to me, has more girl power than I have ever had. I want her to have, you know, good self-esteem. And the wonderful thing that she has is she knows her own mind. She knows what she wants and she's not afraid to say it. It's wonderful. She's just so honest. And I think I did have that when I was young, but I think sometimes it kind of gets beaten out of us a little bit as we get older and there are different pressures on us. And
one of the things about becoming famous is that you then spend the rest of your career worrying about not being famous. At the height of your fame, did you suddenly feel, well, what will this be like if it all goes away?
Well, I have an interesting relationship with fame. It was something I craved as a child. I wanted all of the photographs and the autographs, and Madonna is an idol of mine, and I kind of looked at her life, and of course, it was like late 80s and 90s, really incredible period of her career. And it was all like, you know, running in Hyde Park with loads of minders and fans following, and that's what I want. And then I went away to Performing Arts College. I left home when I was 16, which I think is too young. And especially for me, coming from an industrial town in the north, I went to Performing Arts College there, but I was completely single-minded. It was all I wanted to do. And I was auditioning for West End shows and various different things.
That was through the Performing Arts College. They got you auditions and...
Yeah, well, it was a diploma course. I was there for 3 years. And then in your final year, you start looking in newspapers like this stage. Yeah. And we go along to these auditions and I was handed a flyer for a girl band. My ultimate dream always had been to be a singer, to have a record deal. When I got the flyer for the girl band, I turned to my friend and I just said, that's it, that's what I'm going to do. And that went on to be the Spice Girls. It was an open audition, anyone could turn up. I think the flyer read something like between 18 and 24. The first bit was, it's a cattle market, auditioning's horrible. Hundreds of girls turned up and we danced. We just had to freestyle dance to an Eternal song. That was the girl band of the moment. And from that, certain people were picked. So it was obviously on the way you looked and the way you moved, and then you were picked to sing. And then after you'd sung, you would then get called back, or don't call us, we'll call you.
How long was the process?
I think about a week later, I was called and asked to come back for a recall. And I was ill at the time. I had tonsillitis and I ended up having my tonsils out after this. But I was also being recalled for Cats, the musical, as well. And I couldn't go to both of these recalls. And I got my mum to call and beg the management team that were looking for this girl band to please just give me the time to get better, because I really, obviously, really, really wanted to do it. But they were like, no, sorry, we've got the girls now, that's it. And I thought, oh, well, there you go. It wasn't meant to be. And a couple of weeks later, I got another call, maybe about a month later, I got another call to say, oh, it hasn't worked out with one of the girls. We'd like Melanie to come down and sing for us again. Yeah. And I went down to a studio, I think it was in Hammersmith. There was a girl called Jerry, there was a girl called Mel B, a girl called Victoria, and a girl called Michelle. I sang, and then I was in the band. That was it.
And what happened to Michelle?
Then the five, including myself, the five of us, I think we went, I can't remember what it was, we stayed in this B&B, and we did a week of rehearsals or 2 weeks of rehearsals or something. And then it became quite apparent that Michelle was a little bit like that. She wasn't sure. She might be going to uni. Did she want to do the girl band thing? But the other four of us were like, no, you have to be dedicated. So unfortunately, the writing was on the wall for Michelle, and she was...
I wonder what Michelle thinks about it all now.
I think she told the newspapers how she felt about it.
I wasn't really happy. It wasn't really the kind of music which I wanted to be doing.
Once Emma came along, everything fell into place, and that's when we became what people will know as the Spice Girls. If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with
my friends, make it last forever. And do you look back at that and think, do the sliding doors thing, like, supposing that hadn't happened?
I do, and it's quite difficult to imagine what would have happened, and dancing was kind of the main thing that I was doing. It's quite a short-lived career. Now, I'm 44 now, and I think, wow, what would I be doing now? And a lot of my friends have either gone into the fitness industry, yoga teachers, or ballet teachers, you know, dance teachers, and some people just gone into completely different things.
So suppose your daughter came home with a flyer and she said, look, Mum, they're auditioning for whatever. How would you feel?
Well, of course, it's about Britain's Got Talent and X Factor and shows like that now. She sometimes expresses that she'd like to do that, but she's had lots of career choices. Yeah, she loves Britain's Got Talent. Not X Factor so much. But yeah, BGT's big in our house. Yeah, it's pretty decent family viewing, isn't it?
I was very choked up at the end of this year's final. I just thought, do you know what? We have come a long way as a society when a man who cannot speak and has never been able to speak can stand on stage and not look like we've all got used to our idols. Doesn't look anything like that. Mm-hmm. And I found that just incredibly moving. And I thought, well, good on them, actually. You can criticise those programmes for many things, but oh my God, what a fantastic signal that is to other people, whether you're disabled or whoever else it is, just think, he's a winner. He is a winner. Mm-hmm. That is amazing.
I think it's very interesting, actually. I'm finding being a mum with quite a young daughter at the moment, because there are so many changes in our society. Some of it's petrifying, you know, social media completely freaks me out. And obviously, any generation, your children, they're growing up in a world you barely understand. Yeah. There are some really great things. This whole movement, which feels like it's really gathering pace in women being out there and being united and being able to do whatever they want. You know, the thing that the Spice Girls are most proud of is that there was a generation of young girls that now are all grown up, and we get approached all the time by young women saying, you really inspired me, and I started a business, or I went into this career, and it's incredible. And
were you aware of that at the time, the effect you were having?
It was a mixture of things. I think we really didn't understand how huge it was and the effect it was having. Being part of a global pop act in itself is hard. You're dealing with all of your personal things and, you know, being in the public eye and travelling and exhaustion and the pressures and the expectations and all of these things. But then also having the success and achieving these dreams. And we were aware quite quickly that we had very young fans, and we really didn't take that lightly. We knew that was really important. We were role models. For a young person to realise they're a role model, as much as you are just a normal person with all of the issues that anybody has, you have to take that seriously.
And looking back, do you wish it had gone on for longer?
Yeah, I do. It's amazing when we look back. Wannabe was released in 1996, and then Jerry left in 1998. So the real successful years, you know, the big Brits everybody remembers, yeah, and the movie, the two albums, that was all within 2 years. It's crazy, isn't it?
And the impact that has. Still the impact.
There is a lifespan, especially of a pop act like that, of that nature, because you work so hard. I think you burn out. I get asked, probably on a daily basis, are the Spice Girls getting back together? And I remember we reunited in 2007, and I was like, the best thing about this is that people are going to stop asking if we're getting back together.
We've done it now.
And then literally about 2 days after the tour ended, when are you getting back together again? No, it never ends. But, you know, it's lovely that people still care and there's still an appetite. There's an incredible fan base out there who would like to see us girls.
So in your head, are you a Spice Girl? Is that how you think of yourself?
I do. I really do. I think there was a period of time when I wanted to rebel from that. I think it's hard to be, you know, part of something when you're young, and then you feel like you are just seen as part, like a cog in a wheel, when you want to be an individual and be seen as an individual. And so I kind of, you know, the hair came off and I got angry and I did a few rocky songs and, you know, I had my little rebellious phase. You know, I realised what we'd done was so incredible that I really embrace it. And as time goes on, I just become more proud.
So at what point did you think, actually, we're in charge of our own destiny, we can make our own decisions? Was there a moment when you felt that power shift happening?
It actually happened really early on. We were auditioned by a management team. It was father and son, actually. We were working together and we were having vocal coaching and we were singing songs that had been written by other people and doing our choreography and stuff. We were working really hard to come together as a band. And a lot of it probably was naivety, but we were impatient. We wanted to sign a deal, we wanted to move forward, we wanted to get out there. And these guys, we felt they were really dragging their heels. It was probably about 6 months or something, but you know when you're younger, yeah. You're like, we want it now!
We had such a vision and we wanted to write our own songs. We didn't want to be told what to do, what to wear, what to sing.
I remember Chris, who was like our day-to-day, the son who managed us, and he used to say, girls, don't get carried away. Sometimes I think you feel like you're something really special. It's the beginning. We were having none of it. I think once Emma became part of the band, the dynamic just shifted and it felt sparky. We felt like there was something really, really special.
If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends, make it last forever.
We had each other's support and we were just gonna do that. We were in this together. You know, we had each other's backs, we were gonna do it. And so we came to the conclusion for the first time that we were gonna leave our management. They didn't know what they were doing. We wanted to go. I mean, we had done nothing. We had so little experience. So we actually had some demo tapes, as it was the 90s, cassettes, and we set up this whole elaborate plan. And we stole the tapes, and I think they got shoved down Jerry's knickers. I don't know why, like anyone was going to go looking for them. But, you know, all in the drama of the moment. They put us up in a house. We had, like, there was a financial backer helping them out, and we were in this house. And we'd packed up, and we did a bit of a midnight flit, and we were all in Jerry's Fiat Uno, which was all battered because she was always hitting things. And we escaped off, and Victoria had another car, and we all met in a roundabout. And that was kind of our escape. That was our, like, Thelma and Louise moment. From that moment, I think it made us realise that we really could do anything.
Stop right now, thank you very much. I need somebody with a human.
We'd had a showcase, which we'd pushed for, and it was in these studios in London, and we'd had certain songwriters and publishers and producers come down, and that was the first time we'd been exposed to an audience, really. And we could just feel the interest and the excitement in the room. So we'd found a way of like getting some of these contacts and we just approached these people ourselves. We went on to demo most of the first album without any management at all. We took our destiny into our own hands quite early on. We maintained that then throughout the career. And of course, the music industry is very male dominated.
Still is.
Predominantly the people I work with are men. All of my bands are men. Most of the songwriters I work with, producers, everyone. There are more and more women coming, but it feels quite gradual.
How do you think that affects the women in the business?
I think because traditionally, with it being male-dominated, that there is change happening, and I'd love to work with more women. I've worked with very few female songwriters.
It's like in the film business, there are only 7% of film directors are women. 7% here now, where we are now.
Yeah.
It's not coal mining. Why? What is the reason for it? It doesn't make any sense.
It's really, it's
nobody,
nuts, isn't
nobody
it?
Would ever argue that women are less creative than men. And even
Catherine Bigelow, who was the first and only woman to win an Oscar for directing. And she's not inundated with offers to make other films, even though she, you know, she won an Oscar and, you know, it's an unbelievably acclaimed film.
I think my experience with the music industry is, and it is changing because the music industry has changed so much over the past like 10, 15 years.
But in that respect, has it?
But it's a bit of a boys' club. There are younger people coming up now and things are changing and attitudes are changing. But I think it's hard. It's kind of, you know, it's going to take time.
You don't make changes without being very active about it. These things aren't going to happen by chance. So there have to be people who push it on. And I suppose I was fortunate in that when I was at the BBC, it was at a time when suddenly women were starting to rule the roost. So I was there when the first woman was made channel controller, which was Jane Root, BBC Two, the first woman, Lorraine Hegarty, to be controller of BBC One. My boss ran television. The woman that ran drama was a woman. There was a lot of us women there. And then, of course, once that happens, you then are in a position to, you know, to make changes. Mm. But you look in, say, Strictly Come Dancing and the two women presenting it, that's brilliant. Whereas for decades, there's been shows which is only men that nobody goes, oh, it's only men, Monty Python, all men. Or, you know, the two Ronnies or Morecambe Wise, nobody went, two men, how strange. You know, where were the women? Put two women together and it's still seen as a bit of an oddity.
In this day and age, it really, really is. I think it's just catch up, isn't it? It is. It's going to take a long time to have that equality, but it's moving in the right direction.
I think what happens is that people sort of replicate what they know and what's like themselves. So it is going to take that kind of major shift.
I feel in the music industry, people are afraid to make mistakes. So they will often go with what they know or to replicate something. Do you feel like it's been like that in TV as well?
People are frightened to make mistakes. I think I've always been, in that sense, a bit reckless because the truth is, nobody knows if a show's going to be a hit. When I commissioned Strictly Come Dancing, everybody thought before it started that I'd lost it. She's bringing back ballroom dancing to a Saturday night. She really doesn't know what she's doing. In my head, it didn't feel like a risk. Gosh, to see celebrities trying to learn to ballroom dance with professionals, I think when are you really hurt is if you have something that's a flop, that's a copycat of something else, because there's no excuse for that, and there's far too much of that. Mm. In films, in TV, let's just do another one of those, because we know the audience likes it.
It's really interesting, actually, because just thinking about conversations I've had with the girls, and Jerry springs to mind in particular, where we always have tried to do things differently, you know, to be courageous, to be the first. I mean, the thing I found as well in the music industry is we're obsessed with age. Working in pop music, oh my goodness, you know, you don't get played on Radio 1 once you're past a certain age. And that's a bitter pill to swallow, you know, when you still feel very youthful.
So in TV, where everybody is trying to get, you know, and it's always been the case to get more young people to watch TV, which mm-hmm. is getting harder and harder and harder because obviously there are now many more things yeah. that people can do. But people, I think, are mistaken when they think that young people necessarily want to watch other young people on television. So I remember when I launched The Weakest Link with Anne Robinson, we had not just a huge audience, but a huge young audience, because it's about the attitude. They loved her attitude, which was so different than anything ever been seen. I don't see why in the music business it has to be the case.
There's something about the Spice Girls music, and I think the attitude and how colourful and a little bit chaotic it all is and was, it still appeals to young people. But the music still, you know, stands the test of time.
And I think it's sad now that nobody's allowed to get old or look old, you know, that's like, especially in America. But I think the pressure on people to sort of stay looking young forever if you're on screen is just horrible.
You know, I found the pressures immediately.
What did you think fame would bring then?
It will be the cure-all. You will be happy, you will be confident, you will be loved, you will be rich. I mean, weirdly, money didn't come into it at all. It was never a motivation, and it still isn't. You know, I love what I do, I have a passion. And I think the fame thing is probably more complicated, because with a lot of people it is a bit about having this acceptance and being loved and for your self-esteem. You know, I think about aging is, you know, there's nothing we can do about it. And there are some really great benefits of getting older. I'm definitely more chilled. You know, a lot of the things that worried me as a young person have gone. You know, all that wasted energy, all those things used to be so concerned with.
Do you ever see yourself thinking like Cilla Black? You know, she had this amazing career as a singer. Some of those songs, like the Spice Girls, you know, they're just classics, aren't they? And then she reinvented herself, this amazing TV presenter. So can you see yourself being something completely different, or do you want to be in music?
Singing and performing is my absolute first love. You know, one of the biggest things I think I did with the Spice Girls and one of the highlights of my career was performing at the Olympics in 2012. And there was, you know, a billion people watching, and it was the first time we'd performed together and social media had been there at our fingertips. Yeah. You could see the whole world on Twitter waiting for the Spice Girls. And it was incredible. I recently started, like, DJing, like, you know, proper DJing on the decks. And, you know, having to learn. I mean, it's technical. I'm a bit of a novice. I'm just learning, you know, lots of skills. But I love it. And it's music and it's performing. It's a whole new world. And I think going into anything as a Spice Girl, you can't just, like, quietly have a go at something. Yeah. It's like, hey, I'm doing this now.
What about, because you said you auditioned for Cats, so would you like to, can you see yourself doing that?
Yeah, I've done a little bit of theatre. I was in Blood Brothers for 6 months, which was actually a really interesting shift for me. I love theatre, it's a wonderful show. And I just thought, oh, yeah, I want to do this. And I never, for one second, thought about critics or award nomination. And I didn't do it for any of that. I did it because it was a new challenge and it fitted my schedule. It went so well and I was really embraced by the theatre community. And you know, we got great reviews. We got some 5-star reviews. I was nominated for an Olivier. None of this I ever imagined or expected. I noticed a lot of the media, more the broadsheets, I started being taken, you know, a little bit more seriously. When I stopped working with the Spice Girls, like way back in 2001, and I was doing quite well, actually. My first solo record was very successful. But I was going through this whole thing of, like, I'm an individual. I'm not just Sporty Spice. There's more to me. And I was very frustrated. It felt like, obviously, we're so, you know, the media kind of gives us this persona, which so often you don't recognise. There's been so many fantastic female artists. And it was amazing. You know, there's been certain periods of time when the biggest artists in the world have all been women. It's like Beyonce and Adele. And, you know, we've got Little Mix in this country. They're just fantastic girl bands. And it's really lovely to see there are so many more girls doing it. And I really hope to think that the Spice Girls had something to do with that.
Oh, I'm sure they did.
It wasn't only what we did musically and even within pop culture and fashion and all of the things that we affected, but just together, we just gave each other strength. I look at my daughter and I look at younger girls that I see, and they do seem to be very independent and very strong-minded, and I really hope that we have paved the way.
I also think that we've seen what's happened in Hollywood. You know, men have been called out now. People will be much more aware that they cannot behave in that way because the silence has been broken, and luckily you can't go back, and the movements that have come out of it have been so positive. At BAFTA, one of my priorities was definitely diversity in all its forms. And it's not just about gender or race, it's also about class.
A watershed moment to be a catalyst for real, lasting change across the workplace in film, games and television.
I mean, I've never for one moment thought, oh, I wish I'd have been born a man. I'm sure you haven't, because it was being a woman that was what made the Spice Girls so
Absolutely.
Stand out.
And I think kind of put fire in our bellies, because we were told, girl bands don't sell records, or we can't put you on the front cover of the magazine, because when girls are on the front cover, we just don't sell as many copies. This was like a red rag to a bull every time, but it was brilliant, because it was just like, we'll show them. It made us what we became.
Well, people still say that women's subjects don't sell films, and I think film's still got a long way to come. Although it's brilliant, some of the new films that have come out, and Wonder Woman, everything, you know, massive hits, so it shows you, no, you were wrong.
Yeah, totally.
You know, it's like
the fight goes on, the fight goes on, the fight goes on. You can't stand still. You've got to be prepared to be vocal about these things.
Yeah, I absolutely feel the same. A lot has changed and it is very positive, but we can't take our eye off the ball. You know, we have to keep this momentum. I feel very positive about the future for women. I don't think the battle is over. Absolutely not. You're right, if you're going to make a mistake, make your own mistake. You know, don't try and copy somebody else and do like a poor version of it, yeah.
You know, we're all going to have setbacks. It's, I think, how you come back from setbacks that is going to determine how well you do.